Hello everyone, this is Dr. Rachin Goyal. I am working as an associate professor in Department of Mechanical Engineering, Chandigarh Engineering College, Landram, Mohali. Since we are talking about mechanical vibrations, in previous lecture also, we came across few of the terms which are very important from the engineering point of view. So, we were discussing that what was the basic evolution from where this particular type of phenomenon took place. Then we also discussed about what is the importance of mechanical vibrations, what is the basic terminology that should be kept in mind while discussing this subject or studying this subject. We also understood that what is resonance and natural frequency. I am again putting some stress on these two terms, that is mechanical vibrations is primarily focusing upon these two terms, that is natural frequency and resonance, since it is our duty as an engineer or as a researcher to save our structures or machines or vehicles, whatsoever you call them, from the failures. And one of the major reason of failure could be resonance in their structures. Now, resonance we are talking about, it is of course, if I talk about it, when does it occur? Resonance occurs when the frequency of the driving force matches with the natural frequency of the oscillating body. So, you know, every object is having some natural frequency of it. On its own, and that natural frequency when becomes equal to the resonance, when become equal to the driving force frequency of driving force, then it is said that resonance is getting occurred, may occur. Now what does it happen when resonance occur? The amplitude of the vibration reaches unacceptable limits. As you can see, this is an example of narrow bridges, which was Tacoma Narrow Bridge, which was a disastrous failure as observed in 1940. This, the main reason is said to be the resonance at that point of time. After that, Millennium Bridge was also there, which is very popular example, which is being quoted out everywhere, that it is Millennium Bridge was a failure due to the oscillations which reached the resonance level, and the modified oscillations has to be taken care of in order to save that particular structure. We also talked about certain phenomena like microwave, oven, radio, other frequencies, swings. We took the examples of them. Now let us understand that what is this resonance? Always a negative term for engineers? No, it is absolutely not. It can be a positive, it can be taken as positive means also. Where does it help us? Where can it act as a friend for engineers? See, in the case of conveyors, hoppers, compactors, pneumatic drills, mechanical vibrations are responsible, or resonance is responsible to have the work done. In the opening of cork from a wine bottle, it does occur. It is helping in vibration when reaches the resonance levels, also help in washing machines. Mechanical shakers, mixers, sieves, sorters, there are mechanical objects which are taking the usage of this particular term, that is resonance. Similarly, many musical instruments are there which are being used with the help of resonance. Similarly, clocks and watches are there which are using the vibrations. In mechanical engineering field, there are terms which are called as massagers, being used by medical professionals sometime, So these are using the resonance and mechanical vibrations for their usage. But sometimes these terms are taken a negative word in itself. Now, as just we have talked about that Tacoma bridge was there, which was narrow, and it took a very disastrous type of shape when it got failed. Similarly, when we talk about pumps, compressors, aircraft, spacecraft systems, these type of resonance phenomenon could definitely act as a foe for us, since it is not that much useful. Loosening of the parts, noise is there, failures are there due to resonance, then the discomfort and loss of efficiency, of course, if we are not having that much sound structures with us, failures could also be there. So there are many aspects, there are features of resonance that whether it is useful or unuseful for us. So these could be the probable usages that you can witness, and these are certain examples where the negative aspects or negative faces of these vibrations can be seen. Now, inevitably, we need to understand that what are the types of mechanical vibrations. The first and foremost type of mechanical vibrations it is free and forced type of mechanical vibrations. These are the various types on which we can study in detail, that what are the types: free or forced vibrations, then linear and non-linear vibrations, damped and undamped vibrations, deterministic and random vibrations, and longitudinal, transverse and torsional vibrations. So these are the classifications of various types of vibrations, which are very useful to categorize, and for its proper usage we need to understand completely that what are the various types of vibrations. So if we talk about the first type of vibration, that is free or forced vibrations, what do you understand by free vibrations? It is that vibration when we are not putting external force. No external force is the key word. If we are vibrating, we are providing a motion to the body just once, and we are not repeatedly putting some force on it. It is being said that the movement which is the being executed, and of course the oscillations which are being happening there, are called as free or natural vibrations in themselves. Keyword is no external force when applied, but once it has to be applied. Now, in the case of forced vibration, when we talk about the forced vibrations, the influence of external force is always there. Permanent source of external force may be found in those structures. So if we are having some bodies which are being imposed by external sources of excitation, which are inevitably permanently acting on the body, is called as forced vibrations. Now, these disturbances could be periodic and can cause the unbalances in our structures. So these are the things we are interested in while we are talking about free or forced type of vibrations. Another category of it is linear vibrations and non-linear vibrations. So in the case of linear vibrations, two of the aspects have to be taken care of clearly. That is, two criteria has to be taken care of. One, see, this is the all about input and output. If the input X is being given to a system, mechanical system, and output X is being observed, it may be 2x, 3x, whatsoever it is, magnitude of the system is proportional to the system input. Whereas in second case, if the input is X and producing some output capital X, let us say, and small input Y is capital Y output being produced, then input could be X plus Y. In totality, it can be said that every input must be having some output directly related to it in one way or other way. So output that are not present in a system as input will not be there. So if we are having some inputs, definitely against them, there must be some outputs. So that type of systems are called as linear vibrations. Or you can say the basic elements of any mechanical system are mass, elasticity, and damping. So if any of them is having non-linear relation between them, it is called as non-linear vibrations. In other words, you can say that many systems which are nearly linear in their responses for the smaller inputs will be becoming, normally these are becoming non-linear at higher level of their excitations. So it is being observed. So what we have learned from here, linear vibrations are those in which against any input we are having some input in one way or other way. That is, its contribution can never be ignored, either they are interacting or not. Whereas in case of non-linear vibrations, there is linearity which is not existing in any way in real system. In practical world, there are very less vibrations which are linear. Normally many of the vibrations are non-linear in their nature. Another category is damped and undamped vibrations. So when we talk about damped vibrations, as you can see here, excuse me, the amplitude of the vibration is getting decreased with every of the cycle. Amplitude of the vibration, let it be the 5 cycles, 10 cycles, 2 cycles, it will be getting reduced. A reduction in the amplitude over the cycles. So that element, that is damper, normally it is damper, if it is present in the system in one way or other way, damper could not be always a physical system. Damping can be provided in the system in many of the ways, like air is also a dampener itself. Air can be called as a damper. So damped systems are having some damper, and in this case amplitude of the vibration is getting reduced per cycle. Whereas if we talk about the undamped vibrations, any sort of damper, if it is not present, that system is called as undamped. That is, in this case, if we draw this curve, what will be having ideally? This system will go something like this, that amplitude would be remaining same, will not be altering anywhere. So this is the case when we talk about the undamped system. Another category which is very important also is called as deterministic and random vibrations. In the case of deterministic vibrations, we have to understand that magnitude of the excitation, either it is force or motion acting on the system, can be determined at any point of time. If the magnitude of the deterministic vibrations can be taken care of, so, or you can say predictable, the resulting vibration is called as deterministic vibrations. So if it is predictable, determinable, in most of the cases you will observe that what is the frequency like of vibration, if it is determinable, that this will go something like this, it will be reducing after 10 cycles. It is very much deterministic, and it can be pre-planned that this structure could be designed in this way. Or sometimes it is not deterministic, it is not having any pattern. I am not able to understand that what type of vibration is it, although it is vibration, but it is very random in nature. So that type of vibrations which are occurring or being executed due to those forces whose frequency, whose characteristics cannot be predetermined or pre-planned or pre-occurring, that type of systems or that type of vibrations are called as random vibrations, which cannot be calculated in advance. You cannot observe them. So that type of vibrations are called as random vibrations. So this is another category which is very important, that whether our vibrations are deterministic type or random type. We need to understand them. Another important category is longitudinal, transverse and torsional vibrations. In this case, when we talk about the longitudinal vibrations, see this figure clearly. This is the longitudinal axis of the shaft. It is having a disc mounted right here and it is shaft. It is fixed somewhere here. And if we are elongating it with some application of force, it will be executing some vibrations. Now this type of vibration is called as longitudinal vibration, since this is being executed along the axis of the application of force. So that type of vibrations are called as longitudinal vibrations. And if we read these lines clearly, the particles of the shaft or disc move parallel to the axis of the shaft when elongated or shortened alternatively, that is execution of the tensile and compressive stresses alternatively. Whereas in the case of transverse vibrations, if we talk about, in the case of transverse vibrations, this movement or this execution is occurring normal to the axis of longitudinal axis of the shaft and disc. So this is longitudinal and this is normal to it, that is this type of vibration, you can say the vibrations executed in the simple pendulum is called as transverse vibrations. In the third category, we can clearly observe that torsional vibrations are those, like you can see in the case of fans, turbine blades, compressor fans, and so on. So all these are executing the torsional vibrations, whereas the particles of the shaft or disc move in circular motion about the axis of the shaft. So that particular type is called as torsional vibrations. Normally torsional vibrations is having its own terminology to analysis. That we'll see when we'll be talking about the analysis part of it. So these three categories are there. One is longitudinal, transverse and torsional vibrations. Now another thing is, now we have come across many of the things discussed so far, that what are various types of vibrations, why do we understand this subject and so on. Now how to handle the vibrations, how to understand, you know that in order to get them handled, we have to make some models out of them. So how do we model the system? In totality, if we say that how do we model the system? So modeling of the system, see, these are the practical real systems, like you can say an aeroplane or a motorcycle is there. So these are the physical real systems. We have to make the mechanical models out of those, any type of you can say it could be a machine, motorcycle, truck, bus, whatsoever you call them, have to be translated in terms of mechanical models. Now these mechanical models can be in terms of certain basic elements, which are normally, again I am telling you, mass, some elastic element and or some damping element. So these three could be there: one, elastic element, damping element. Now this is mass, this is damper, and this is stiffness element. These are being translated into this, and this is a beam wherein this is particular mass, we consider it or not as mass, and this is again translated to a spring mass system. It is called as a spring mass system. So to convert our system in spring mass system, we have to make a model which clearly depicts the real system in its real sense. Now this type of system cannot be understood more clearly and implicitly, we have to convert again, translate again our model, mechanical model, into the mathematical one, which can be analyzed very properly. Now, since we'll be talking all these things in detail, since it is having three of the elements, of course, these are imposing certain forces into the system. Now, for every element, there is one force. Like for mass, it is, you can say, mx double dot. For spring stiffness, it is kx. For damper, it is cx dot. So for every element, there is some force which is being imposed and it has to be mathematically produced. Similarly, this also, it is having some mass, some damping element and some stiffness element. So it has been converted, or you can say translated, in the form of an equation. Now, how do we get the solutions? There are ways to find out the solution of such equations. In these types of equations, if these are being put in this way, that is, this is, let us say, a damping system. Since damper is present, it has to be some reduction in the vibrations or amplitudes. Whereas if such system is there, it can have 3-4 types of systems critically damped or whatsoever it is. So these have to be having some solution which normally is being kept in a generalized way, with some assumptions, of course. Now, after having these type of relations and charts available with us, we are finally analyzing that what type of vibration is it and how to get them away from our system, how to get rid of them. So in totality, what in this slide has been studied, it is about that how do we handle the vibrations, how do we understand the vibrations, and how do we model them. Since any engineering problem is being handled whenever we are translating them into the reasonable type of models, which can be understood and later on they can be analyzed. Firstly, if I recapitulate it, firstly, we'll be having some real systems available with them. These have to be mechanically modeled using some spring mass systems. Then they have to be mathematically modeled using certain forces. And finally, solution is being carried out and analysis part is being done. So this was the general layout of mechanical system. How do we handle the vibration? Now, in the first of the mathematical modeling, what did we do? We model our mechanical system, real system, into the mechanical system. So this is an example. What are the basic parts? In other words, this is, let us say, an equipment. It could be a motor, compressor, turbine, whatsoever, any electronic component. It is having some payload, which can be considered as mass. Let us say it is 20 kgs. Let us say this mass is 20 kgs. It is being supported by a platform, but within this platform, there are another elements which have been introduced. One is spring stiffness, or spring has been introduced, and another is a damper, which is having some coefficient. Now, damper could be anything. It can be air, it can be liquid, it can be fluidicial whatsoever. So that damper is being introduced, which is having, of course, some damping coefficient denoted by symbol C. Now, it seems that these are having three systems, three of the elements, that is mass, damper and stiffness. It is normally called it, we normally call it as MC and K. So what we have done in this, we have translated our system in MCK. And of course, if some force is being applied here, it will be written as in the vectorial form. It has been translated. Spring having mass not being considered, we are considering mass of the payload of any of the equipment, and it is being supported by some spring having stiffness K, damper having coefficient C. So this is the way out to translate our model. Now, next is how do we model it mathematically. Now, in order to make a mathematical model of it, we have to convert our system in certain mathematical notations. That is, let us say very basic simple example of a mass being tied by with the help of a spring, and it is being imposed by two of the terms. That is, mass which is acting downwards, it is being called as mass into acceleration due to gravity, since it has to become some force or weight, and it will be counteracted by spring force, which will be in the opposite direction to the application of force. So that would be, of course, kx. Now, how kx? See, weight is equal to mass into acceleration due to gravity, so which is a form of force. It cannot be balanced by mass only, it has to be balanced by a force. So that is spring force, you can say. Now, this spring force is equal to spring constant or stiffness into x. How, where does it come from? You know that for stiffness, what is stiffness? It is force per unit deflection. Force per unit deflection. And of course, if force is F, deflection is x, let us say this is k, then in that case spring force will become kx. So that is why force should be balanced by a force, not mass. Now both of these terms are becoming forces. So this is force or weight due to mass m, this is spring force, you can say, and this is force due to mass. This is force due to mass which has been tied here. So in that depth we have to understand the story. Of course, since these are two opposite forces acting on to it, so mx double dot, in order to make the equilibrium, for equilibrium, mx double dot, that is both of the forces have to be taken equal to each other. Why negative? Since it is acting upward and mass is acting downwards. Now this particular equation can be translated into mx double dot. Now what is this double dot? What is this double dot right here? We'll be taking it further also. Double dot is basically acceleration. So I'll be telling you in the next slide about this thing. Before that, let us take another example of which is very much analogous to it in the case of torsional systems. So let us see, we are having a support here. It is being tied, it is being welded with, you can say, in some way joined with a shaft, and then finally a disc has been mounted here. It can be translated, this real system, it has been translated into a spring mass system. And now where is the spring in this case? Where is the spring? When we talk about mass spring, spring does not necessarily means spring, but it is an elastic element. The action should be springy. So in this particular thing, this particular as well as this one, both of them, that is shaft as well as disc, are made up of such material which is elastic in its nature. So that is why we can say that it is having some springy action or elastic action in it. So that acts as mass, spring. Now if we see its top view, if we are providing it a rotary motion against the axis, longitudinal axis, it will be having some motion execution in the plane of this board. Okay, this way. About the mean position, of course, since the vibration is being understood in the terms of when it is being disturbed from its mean position to the extreme position. So it will be executing some vibrations. So in the similar case as we discussed just in the case of linear system, that was the equation. Now the equation has taken bit different shape. In this equation now, this mass has become I, x double dot has become theta double dot, k has become most precisely torsional stiffness, and x has become theta again. So the equation has been translated into I theta double dot plus k theta is equal to 0. So moment of inertia, of course, which is I, normally you know it is equal to mk square. What is m in it? It is mass of the element. What is k? It is radius of gyration. Now, why do we translating these things? Mass is considered as second mass of area, or you can say moment of inertia, if we are talking about the torsional systems in place of translational systems, or you can say linear systems. So this is taking the shape of these type of elements. So in up to this point, we have discussed about various important aspects, that how do we model the mathematical real systems into mechanical and then into the mathematical models. Now in the coming lectures, we'll be understanding about that how do we solve them, which is the real sense problems for us, that how do we solve them. These things will be taken care of in the upcoming lecture of this series. So for this time, I am just recapitulating. Today we have discussed that how do we convert or translate our system from mathematical, from real to the mathematical. As you can see in this slide, that this was the main crux, that how do we convert our systems from some physical or real systems to the spring mass systems, or you can say mechanical models, then from mechanical models to some mathematical models, then solution, then analysis. So I hope it was well understood by all of you. In the coming lectures, I'll be again discussing about that how do we solve them. For any queries, you can contact me at my email ID, which have been provided in the earlier slide. So you can also note it down. So this lecture was hopefully a very important as well as very useful for all of you. You can take pick of it. You can contact me anytime for this type of query. Thank you very much.